don't remember being wealthy before. I want those to stay. I want those to stay. I want those to stay. Not just today or tomorrow, but
tonight. I heard for the first time last weekend. I'm down in South Wales for a storytelling conference, and a friend of mine, Kat Little, she's based in Cardiff, and she does a lot of work in a centre called the Oasis Centre. And the Oasis Centre is open for anybody to go in, but for particularly targets people who are refugees, asylum seekers, or people who come the first time. So it's a welcoming place for everybody. And in the Storytelling Festival, they had an hour where we sang some songs and told some stories. And Kath told this story, and I thought this would be a good story for tonight. And she heard this story from one of the people who came to the centre. His name was Saeed. He had come to this country from Iran, and he applied for asylum, and recently he got the right to remain. But this is a great, but I really enjoyed listening to the story. And the story involves a railway track. A long railway track, an important railway track. And for some reason, I'm not too sure why she didn't explain. Two trees started to grow alongside the railway track. Maybe they're blown in by the breeze. Maybe someone's going by and dropped a couple of seeds. Or maybe someone just decided to plant two trees by a railway line. Who knows? And those two trees, they grew side by side by the railway track, bigger and bigger, until they were huge, providing a little bit of gentle shade as the trains went by. Until one night a storm came by. Might have had a crazy name like Storm Hector, I'm not too sure. But the storm came by and those two trees were rocked and shaking about. They really were, the whole roots were starting to move in the soil. Then one of the trees felt its roots really shaking and got really unsteady. And he said to the tree, "Help me, help me, I'm gonna get blown over." just gave me, let me lean against you for a while. But the other tree thought to itself, hang on a minute. If I lean against me, I might get pushed over. I know we've grown side by side, but we're not really friends. We're just two random trees happen to be here. I mean, you hear people about looking after yourself. I'm frightened of it. It's no point both of us getting blown over. So do you know what he decided to do? Refuse the other tree any help. And that tree blew over and fell right across the railway tracks. But in the morning, the other tree was standing there, nice and proud. Roots still in the ground. It was doing all right. And as we were standing there in the morning, sun came up. Workmen came to move that other tree. So I think I made the right decision there. And they saw them chopping all the tree up. And all the tree got moved off the railway line. But then he saw something that made his leaves quiver. And the sap stopped rising up its branches. Because the men, once they cleared all that wood away, turned their attention to the other tree. Looking at it, looking at the railway line, and then the next thing the tree felt was a buzzsaw going against its trunk. And he wished he had thought differently the night before.
Mary, welcome.
Hi, I'm not sure how thematic this story is, so you may have to stretch your amnesty minds a bit. That's good exercise for you. It does have a moral, and it just goes to show that if you want something important, sometimes you have to go places you wouldn't choose to go and deal with people that you might not otherwise want to meet. There was once a kingdom. And in the kingdom there were many villages. And in one village, one day, a baby was born. And it was born with a caul over its face. That's a layer of skin, extra skin. Now at that time, that was considered very lucky. And before you knew what was happening, the local fortune teller had come forward and she read the signs and then she made her pronouncement. She said, when this boy, because it was a boy, when this boy grows up to be a young man, he will marry a princess. Well, it didn't seem very likely, but they had a lot of respect for her. The parents, who were very poor, were pleased at this and they hoped that it was true. Well, shortly after this event, a man arrived in the village. He was, in fact, the king in disguise. He liked to go round his kingdom in disguise, looking to see what his people were up to. It wasn't that he was interested in their welfare, it's because he didn't trust them. So he didn't let on who he was, but he realised that a celebration had been going on. He found out what it was, the birth of a child. And then he was told the story about the prediction. Well, the princess was his daughter. And he wasn't pleased. He was not pleased at all. This was not the future that he would want for his daughter. So because he was the king, he decided to do something about it. Well, because he was incognito, he couldn't call forward soldiers to arrest the family and all that. So he went to the parents and he said, I'm here, I'm a traveller, but actually he said, I'm quite a rich man. He said, and your baby, he said, I'm really interested in your baby. I would like to offer your baby a good life. Take this gold and I will take this boy away and he will have the life that you couldn't give him. Well, what parent would want to give their baby away? But they loved this baby and they remembered the fortune, the prediction, and they thought, well, in this village he's not got much chance of meeting the princess. So they took the gold and they agreed. But the king, instead of taking this baby to a new and wonderful life, took him and put him in a box and closed the lid up firmly and took the box to the river and set the box in the river and sent it off down the river where he was confident in due course the baby would drown. But it didn't. The box proved to be quite watertight, and it went on for miles and miles and miles and miles and miles until it got caught in a mill dam, where the miller found it, and he thought it'd be full of treasure. He was delighted. He took the box out, opened it, and there was a baby. And he was disappointed at first, but his wife was thrilled because they didn't have a child. And she persuaded the miller that they should keep the baby. They shouldn't try and find the parents who clearly abandoned it. And so they took this baby and they brought it up as their own. And he grew up to be a fine young man. He was a bit conceited because they spoiled him. But he was otherwise a fine young man. He was strong and he was quick and he was smart. And when he became a young man, one day, the king was riding past, because actually the palace wasn't very far away from the mill. And a torrential rain came down and the king sought shelter in the miller's house. Well, he spotted this young man. He noticed his quickness, he noticed his strength. He didn't seem to quite fit in with the miller, who was a bit stolid. Fine man, but a bit, you know, not like his son. So he asked about the lad, and the miller told him the tale, how this was a foundling, and how he'd found them in a box. And the king realised who this young man was, and he was appalled. And he thought, well, I better do something about this. So he thought, and he said, young man, come here. He said, you look a fine young man. He said, could you carry a message to the palace? He said, I want to send a message to my wife, the queen. Oh, certainly, said the young man. So he gave him a couple of coins and he gave him a letter addressed to the queen in fine writing, and the young man put it to his pocket and he set off. Now this letter contained instructions to the queen that when she was to open it and read it, she was to have the bearer of this letter executed immediately. Of course, the young man didn't know this. Anyway, he set off and he was doing well, but then he came to the forest and somehow he went right instead of left, or left instead of right, and before he knew where he was very lost. And it was getting dark, and he was getting a bit worried, because there were wild animals in this forest. And then he saw a bit of a gleam of a light in the distance, and he went for it, and it turned out to be a house, and the gleam was a guttering candle. And he knocked on the door, and a voice inside said, "What do you want?" And he said, let me in, give me shelter for the night, I'm lost. And the door opened and there was this old woman and she said, oh, young man, she said, you better not come in here. She said, this is the home of the robbers. She said, if they find you here tonight, they'll like us not murder you, because that's what they do. And the young man said, oh, I'm exhausted, I don't care. Frankly, I don't care, I'm exhausted. I said, I'm coming in, I'll sleep on that bench and take my answers. So the old woman, she felt a bit sorry for him. So she gave him some food and she let him lie out on the bench and he fell dead asleep. And the robbers came back. Well, they were not pleased, as the woman predicted. Who's this? Who's this crowding in our house? They said. Get your knife out, George. Have it. See him off. Oh, the woman said, this is a poor young man who's got lost. And he told me he's got an important letter to deliver. He's no harm in him. Why not leave him alone? Letter? Let's have a look at this letter. So they read the letter. And they were appalled, because they realised that the rich and powerful were just as dishonest and wicked as they were. And they decided to teach the king a lesson. So they tore up the original letter and they wrote another one themselves. Found the one that could write the best of all of them. And this letter said to the queen, the bearer of this letter, you should immediately arrange to marry our daughter. So in the morning, the young man woke up alive and he was given breakfast and he was sent off with his letter and he arrived at the palace and he handed it over and the queen read it. And because the king was the sort of husband he was, she tended not to question what he said, even though it seemed to be odd, frankly, because he didn't look like the sort of young man that she was expecting her daughter to marry. But she arranged a wedding immediately, and so when the king arrived back, the reception was in full swing. And he was amazed, astonished, and then furious when he discovered what had happened, but she showed him the letter. And he realised that somebody had tricked him. And he thought, well, He said, I'm going to have to do something about this. So he said to the young man, he said, come forward, young man. He said, right, he said, you've married my daughter, but he said, I'm the king. He said, so I can undo this if I want. You're going to have to show that actually you are a worthy husband to her. And I'm going to send you on a task. All right, said the young man. He said, I want you to go and get 3 golden hairs off the head of the devil. Oh, said the young man. All right. And off he went. I told you he was a bit conceited. Anyway, he went off on his journey. He found out where the devil lived, which was at the other end of the world. And he set off and he walked and he walked and he walked and he walked. And he walked for miles and miles. And one evening he came to a city just before nightfall. And in those days, it wasn't wise to sleep outside the city gates. So he hurried to the gates to be let in before they were closed. And the gatekeeper said, hey, hang on, he said, we're not just let in anybody. He said, who are you? What's your trade? And the young man, who was full of himself, said, well, I'm Jack of all trades. His name was Jack, by the way. And the gatekeeper said, oh, well, I say, well, then you can help us, young Jack of all trades, he said, because you can tell us why our well in the middle of the city, which hitherto has given nothing but the finest wine, has now dried out and won't even give water. Certainly, said the young man. He said, but I have a task to do. He said, so on the way back, I'll tell you. Well, for some strange reason, they trusted him. So they let him sleep the night and they let him go the next day. And he travelled and he travelled and he travelled until he came to another city. Gates, gatekeeper, same challenge, same answer. And this gatekeeper said, well, he said, if you're a jack of all trades, he said, you can tell us why the tree in the middle of our city, which formerly gave off golden apples, is now shriveling and doesn't even flower. Certainly, said the young man, but I'm off on an important journey, and when I come back, I'll tell you. Well, they also let him go, and eventually he came to the great river, across the other side of which was the devil's house at the gates of hell. There was a ferry, well, there had to be, really. And he got in, and the ferryman was the moaning sort. He moaned the whole way, and it was a wide river, so it was a long journey. Moan, moan, moan. And the song of his moan was that he was fed up with being the ferryman. He'd been the ferryman nearly forever, and he just didn't know how to get out of this job. And the young man said, oh, well, I'm just off to see the devil, he said. I'll find out for you, and I'll tell you on the way back. So he was taken across the river. He got to the house of the devil around about tea time, and he just knocked on the door, as he would. Unfortunately for him, the devil wasn't in, but his grandmother was, a fine old lady. And there was something about this young man. He seemed to appeal to the older woman. So instead of sending him packing, she welcomed him in and she listened to his story. And she said, well, if he finds you, he'll eat you, frankly, as you are, because he doesn't actually like human beings. But I'll turn you into an ant and hide in my skirt and I'll see what I can do. So she fed him, turned him into an ant and waited for her grandson, the devil, to come home, which he duly did. In a foul mood, as usual. Oh, you woman, Gran, what have you got for my tea? Same stuff as usual, I suppose. What's that horrible smell? I'm sure I can smell human flesh. She said, oh, you're always saying that. I don't know why you don't like human beings, she said. Just stop complaining, sit down and have your tea. So she gave him his food, and after his food, he did what he always did. He lay down and went to sleep and started snoring horribly. His head was in her lap. She soothed him with some singing, and when he was dead asleep, she plucked one of his golden hairs, and he woke up. What's that? What are you doing? Oh, it's all right, she said. I just started because I had a dream, and I dreamt that there was a town where there was a well where it used to give out fine wine, and it didn't give it out anymore, and the people were all very unhappy. Oh, he said, they're fools, he said. It's pretty obvious, he said. At the bottom of that well, if they bothered to dig down, they'd find a toad. And that's what's stopping the wine coming. He said, if they got rid of the toad, the problem solved. Stupid people. And he went back to sleep. when he was dead snoring. Again, the second hair. He woke up. What's all this? And she said, oh, I'm sorry, son. She said, I had another dream. She said, I dreamt there was another city with a tree and the people were really unhappy because it used to give off golden apples and now it was all shriveling up. He said, they're really stupid, those people. If they bothered to dig down, they found a mouse gnawing at the roots. If they got rid of the mouse, then the tree would flourish again. Oh, interesting, said her grandmother. Back to sleep he went. And then, when he was snoring again, a third and final hare, he woke up. And this time, she said, my dream was, you know that ferryman that works on the river? Well, in my dream, he was moaning at me about how he wanted to give up his job, but he couldn't. Oh, said the devil, he's the biggest fool of all. All he's got to do is persuade somebody else to take the oars off him, and he's free. Well, the ant was listening to all this. In the morning, the devil went off to do what the devil does during the day. The grandmother handed over the three hares, golden hares. The young man goes back to the river, gets on the boat, and the ferryman says, hang on, before I take you across, what about my question, problem you agreed to solve? Yeah, said the young man, other side of the bank, I'll tell you. Other side of the bank, when he gets off, he does tell the ferryman the solution to his problem, and then makes off to make sure that he isn't the one who takes on the job. Gets to the city of the tree, dying tree, and he tells them about the mouse. And they find out the devil was telling the truth. That was the problem. And they were so delighted, they gave him a cart full of gold. The next city, he tells them the solution to their problem. And they were thrilled because the devil again was true in what he was saying. Toad, get rid of the toad, big cartload of gold, and the young man travels home. The king is on the parapet of his palace, and he's astonished and, of course, not pleased when he sees the young man, who he was confident he would never see again in his life, coming back, not only looking pleased with himself, but behind him, two carts, their axles groaning with gold. Well, the king couldn't believe it, but he knew when he was beat. So he welcomed the young man into the palace, welcomed him into the family. But then he took him on one side and he said, this gold, he said, how did you get it? Where is it? Is there any more? Because he's a very greedy man. Well, the young man had begun to get the measure of his father-in-law by now. And he said, oh, he said, yes. He said, most fortunate, he said. On the river, it takes you across to the devil's house. The far bank is, in fact, made completely of gold. He said, but I'm tired now, so if you want to go and collect some, help yourself. And, you know, have a good time. So off the king goes. And he journeys and he journeys and he journeys and he journeys until he gets to the river. And there's the ferryman, looking grumpy as usual. And the king was, in fact, as he didn't have a lot of traffic, as you can imagine, not that many visitors go and see the devil, as it turns out. So he'd had to wait a long time for his next fare. But he saw the king and, oh, he thought, this is good. Only had to wait 9 months since I was told how to get rid of my job. And as the king got in, the king said, will you row me across to that bank? Yes, he said, yes, I will. He said, but I just need to do something with the rudder. He said, would you mind just taking the oars while I go to the back of the boat? Well, the king didn't normally help anybody, but he was so greedy, he was prepared to do anything to get to the other side of the bank. So he said, certainly, took the oars, the ferryman leapt out of the boat, and there was the king, stuck with the ferry. You may wonder if he's still there, rowing the ferry, because this was a long time ago. Well, I don't know, but if you're that interested, I'd suggest you go and find out for yourselves.
Because, as I'm sure most of you know, today is the longest day of the year. sunrise, 4:34 this morning, 4:43 this morning. So I'm lying there in bed, sleeping, but having very strange dreams about forebodings to do with the end of the world as we know it. At 3:30 I wake with a start, and something tells me I have to be at the sunburst gates at the entrance to Prince's Park before 4:30 in the morning. So I scrabble around in my early morning, whatever one does in the early morning. I manage to get down there for 4:30. It's obviously starting to get a little bit light by now. There's nobody else there except for one stately, very tall, flame-haired young woman. "I am Tefnut," she says to me, "daughter of Ra, the Sun King. He has an important announcement to make very shortly, and I need to take you to where this will be." She heads off into the park, clicks her fingers, better than that, and suddenly I'm surrounded by all the people I have ever known in my life. Friends, relatives, enemies, colleagues. And then suddenly there's another group of people that I don't know, and I assume they must be all the people that I'm ever going to meet in the rest of my life. And there are not so many as the previous lot. We move on, heading towards the lake. Tefnut clicks her fingers again, and one by one, from behind a tree, the beetles appear. Not as we perhaps, well, very much as we remember them, but 10 foot tall, each of them. I'm in their Sergeant Pepper gear because it's now 50 years since Sergeant Pepper, so that's the correct one. And they sing "Good Day Sunshine." But of course, you know, if I can remember it, I feel good in a special way. I'm in love and it's a sunny day. But of course, it's not yet. It may not even be, but that's to come. The Beatles join us, and we move along, heading for the lake. Tefnut clicks her fingers again. By this time I've called her Tufnut, because really she's pretty well in command of the whole shebang. And there's a light over the trees. And there, more than 10 foot, goodness knows how tall, there is Aretha Franklin singing her heart out for that lucky old sun. Has nothing to do but roll around heaven all day. Of course, it's not rolling yet, but we'll see what happens. Tefnut clicks her fingers, we move on. Aretha Franklin joins us and the Beatles, and we head alongside the Prince's Park Lake, skirting the small island where the Mandela 8 Memorial is going to be very shortly in memory of Nelson Mandela and what he stood for. And suddenly, bursting from the lake, there he is, Nelson Mandela, robes dripping. And he makes one of his famous statements, which is why I need my piece of paper, but I never remember them. "The greatest glory in living lies not in never falling, but in rising every time we fall." So he's risen and he joins the group, and we head off towards the Woodhenge on the other side of the park, where the Squash Nutrition Group organise every year a fantastic party, starting at dawn, ending at dusk. So they're very busy all day with tents and food and drink, and lots of singing and dancing. And some people sleep out all night the night before. But by now we would have expected that the sun was really starting to come up, but things are a bit dull and there is a kind of doom-laden atmosphere about it. So we're not quite sure what's going to happen with this, to this assembled throng. And then there is a kind of lightning, and over the top of the trees in the east, where we would expect the sun to appear, it does indeed appear, that small beginnings of the disk. But unlike the sun that we would normally expect to see in its beautiful yellow glory, it's coming up just a very dull, rather shameful red, and it's creeping up in a way that I think it feels as though it's in pain. Tefnut, toughener again. Over the trees, above the sun, Ra appears in his chariot. Horses rearing, nostrils flaring, red flame. Ra there, head of a hawk, normally with a big disc on his head this time. It's a bright red disc, but normally it's a bright red disc. This time, it's a very dull red disc. So, he says, I have got something to say to you. I'm not sure how to say this, but I will try it. He stands up very tall and speaks in a very bitter tone. He says, you have squandered, in a few hundred years, all the coal and oil and gas that took me a million years to make. You are only now trying to store for the future the heat and wind and water that have been there since time began. You can cut down in days forests that will take hundreds of years to grow back. You have poisoned the earth with your chemicals, the air with your fumes, and the rivers and seas with your plastics. When will you ever learn? This red sun, he said, is caused by the dust from man-made deserts. Take it as a final warning. Whether tomorrow it will shine as bright as usual is over to you. The horses rear up. Ra sits in his seat. Tefnut clicks her fingers, shoots up into the air, red hair flaming into the chariot, followed by Aretha Franklin, the Beatles, and Nelson Mandela. And they disappear off, over, obviously, to the west, to repeat the process as the sun comes up, comes up, comes up, as they go over to the west. And we hear them, tomorrow may rain, so I'll follow the sun. So that's it. But if you do follow the sun, make sure you follow the sun with the small s, not the sun. Thank you. Right, now we have Jeremy. Jeremy, who is going to regale us with...
I am called Jeremy. By my next door neighbour's granddaughter. When I was a teenager, I was slightly embarrassed to be called Jeremy, because it's rather a naff, isn't it? Like, I regard it as a naff name. So some of my friends used to call me Jerry, which upset me mother. But now we live in the age of Jeremy, don't we? And it's not just Corbyn, it is Jeremy Vine, Jeremy Paxman, Jeremy Kyle. So I am now, right.
You're now joining the famous Jeremy's.
Yeah. It has been, right. Now, Right. Does anybody know what this is? This is it's a resonator guitar, and it was designed in the 1930s, before we had amplification, and jazz bands, particularly in the States, wanted an instrument that could be as loud as a trumpet or a trombone, so they devised this one. Right, but the story is not about... my story is a story with music, and I won't tell you what the subject is until I've sung the first song, and I think you'll recognise as soon as we get to the halfway through the first line what this is all about. I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Says I, but Joe, you're 10 years dead, I never died, said he. I never died, said he. The copper bosses killed you, Joe, they shot you, Joe, says I. Takes more than guns to kill a man, says Joe, I didn't die. Says Joe, I didn't die. And standing there as big as life and smiling with his eyes, says Joe, what they could never kill went on to organize, went on to organize. Joe Hill ain't dead, he says to me, Joe Hill ain't never died. Where workers stand out on strike, Joe Hill is at their side. Joe Hill is at their side. From San Diego up to Maine, in every mine and mill, where workers stand up for their rights, it's there you'll find Joe Hill. It's there you'll find Joe Hill. I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Says I, but Joe, you're 10 years dead, I never died, said he. I never died, said he. Well, Joe Hill wasn't Joe Hill. Joe Hill was born Joe Hogland, sometimes he's known as Joseph Hillstrom, and he was born in 1879 in a little Swedish port called Galve, which is on the eastern side of Sweden on the Baltic Sea. He was one of 9 children. And when he was 9, his father Olaf died, so his mother had to bring them up. She took him washing, apparently. She kept the family together, but she herself died quite young in 1902. So what the children did was to sell the family house, and Joe Hill and his brother Paul decided to emigrate to the States. So they caught a boat from Oslo to Hull. You know what's coming. They took the train from Hull to
Liverpool.
And this area that we're in tonight used to be absolutely full of very cheap lodging houses where people, emigres, were waiting
for their boat, or waiting for a boat was cheap enough. And so it is possible that Joe, well, it's probable, not possible, that Joe Hill walked the strange streets that we walked tonight. Anyway, he emigrated to the States, got to New York, and he got work as a docker. And then he decided to go west, and he ended up in California. Briefly, he went over to Mexico. He fought in the War of Mexican Independence. Quite a lot of socialists decided to join the cause, and he fought briefly there. In about 1910, he was working in the docks in San Pedro, and he joined a union, and it was called the International Workers of the World. There were two unions in the States at the time, and the IWW, who is known as the Wobblies, they were the slightly more left wing and difficult for the bosses to deal with. Anyway, Joe joined them. He became very active in the union, writing for their paper. But above all, he used his skill as a songwriter, because he realised that a 3,000 word pamphlet wouldn't be read by everybody, but a song that could be sung, everybody could join in. And the IWW produced a songbook. And here it is. This is the IWW songbook. And what they did was to take a tune that everybody knew and write new words for it. So there's the Workers' Marseillaise, and there's one here that really I took, so I thought we'd take them. Oh, here we are. This is called Onward One Big Union, to the tune of Onward Christian Soldiers. So, onward one big union, joy and justice led, with the free society shining out ahead. And so it goes on. And there's one here to the tune of John Brown's Body called Solidarity Forever. When the union's inspiration through the workers' blood shall run, there can be no greater anywhere beneath the sun. Yet the force of earth is weaker than the feeble strength of one, but the union makes us strong. Actually, the socialist singers, you could you could do with this. I picked that up on YouTube. Oh, here we go. The song that I'm going to sing now is called "The Preacher and the Slave." Joe Hill wrote it. I do hope there's no members of the Salvation Army present. A fine body of people, but Joe wrote this song in criticism of that. Their song was, I think, called "By and By." It has a chorus, and I know now we've got the socialist singers with it, you can really cotton on to this. It's got an echo in it, so when we get to the chorus, I will sing "You Will Eat," and you sing "You Will Eat By and By, By and By, in the glorious land above the sky, way up high. Work and pray, live on hay, live on hay. You'll get pie in the sky when you die."
It's a lie.
Well done. I knew I'd be amongst friends. I didn't know you were from. Actually, that phrase "pie in the sky" entered the English language through this song. So Joe Hill's contribution was not only to socialism and songs and trade unionism, but also to the English language. So when I get to the last verse, it is slightly different. So I'll tell you when the last verse is, so you need to listen. Okay. Long-haired preachers come out every night, try to tell me what's wrong and what's right. When they ask me about something to eat, they will whisper in voices so sweet, you will eat, by and by, in the glorious land above the sky, way up high, work and pray, live on hay, you'll get pie in the sky when you die. That's a lie, and the Salvation Army they play, and they sing and they clap and they pray, till they get all your coins on the drum. Then they tell you you're nothing but a bum. You will eat, by and by, in the glorious land above the sky, at the sky. Work and pray, live on hay, you'll get pie in the sky when you die. That's a lie, and the holy rollers and jumpers come out, and they holler and they jump and they shout. Give your money to Jesus, they say, he will cure all diseases today. You will eat, by and by, in the glorious land above the sky, way up high, work and pray, live on hay, you'll get pie in the sky when you die. If you fight hard for children and wife, try to make something good in this life. You're a sinner and a bad man, they tell. When you die, you're sure go to hell. You will eat, by and by, in the glorious land above the sky, way up high. Work and pray, live on hay, you'll get pie in the sky when you die. Working men of all countries unite, side by side we're for freedom we'll fight. When the world and its wealth we have gained, to the grafters we'll sing this refrain. Last verse, you will eat, by and by, when you've learned how to cook and how to fry, chop some wood will do you good, then you'll eat in the street, by and by, that's no lie. Well, clearly, if that's all that happened to Joe Hill, we wouldn't be. He would be a passing note in history. But he became. This is the reason why he became known internationally. And that is because when he was working in San Pedro, he met a friend of his called Otto Appelquist. And Otto said, there's not much work here. I'm going to go to Salt Lake City. Salt Lake City, anybody's been there, it's where the Mormons have their cathedral and hold sway. So Otto went to Salt Lake City, he found somewhere to live, and he got a job in a copper mine. And he wrote to Joe and said, come over. So Joe by this time has been hounded by the people in San Pedro. So he decided to go. And Otto made a big mistake. He introduced him to his girlfriend called Hilda Eriksson, also Swedish extraction probably. And Joe wrote her a love song. And as a result of that, Joe and Otto had an altercation that ended up with Joe being shot in the shoulder. And that was the 10th of January. Otto was mortified that he had killed his friend. Not killed his friend, sorry, no, injured his friend. So Otto took him to the doctors, to Dr. McHugh, who patched him up and sent him on his way. Now, something else also happened on the 10th of January. A grocer called John Morrison and his son Arling were shot dead when somebody broke into their shop. John Harrison was an ex-policeman, so the police were very keen to find out his murderer. So much so, they immediately arrested 12 people, but that didn't include Joe. But they had to let the 12 people go, and eventually they cottoned on to Joe. So they charged him, and he was tried in court. The case against Joe Hill was non-existent, other than he had a bullet wound in his shoulder. But Joe refused to tell anybody who had shot him. He thought that the charges were so trumped up that bad to get off. But of course, he was found guilty. And he went through appeal after appeal to no avail. The campaign to release him, to give him leniency, was quite colossal. It involved the Swedish ambassador. People in Sweden were writing to Governor Spray, who was the governor the governor of Utah. Even President Woodrow Wilson, President of the United States, wrote to the governor asking for clemency. But Governor Spray refused. Even Hilda Eriksson herself, on the 3 days before his execution, wrote to Governor Spray saying, explaining what had happened in the lodging house, and that's how he got his shot. But to no avail, he faced a firing squad on the 19th of November 1915. The commander said, ready, aim, and Joe himself said, fire, go on, fire. And he didn't want his body to remain in Utah for a moment longer. So he organized the IWW organized for his body to be taken for a commission to Chicago. And when his body arrived in Chicago, the train was met by thousands and thousands and thousands of people. Socialists, trade unions, humanitarians, no members from Amnesty International, of course, because they weren't formed then, but there would have been. We'd have all been there, wouldn't we?
We're all there.
Yes, we would have all been there. Then the IWW did something, because it was in his will. It was in this little booklet, also contains a copy of his will, which Joe read in verse. Can't find it, never mind. He asked for his ashes to be strewn to the winds, where they could help grow flowers. So his ashes were put in 600 envelopes. and distributed to IWW members all over the world, especially in Sweden. And on a set day, it was going to be the 1st of May, but somehow it was a cock-up and it wasn't, so it was another day. 600 of these envelopes were distributed. This is the twist of the story. All good stories have a twist. In 1988, one of those envelopes was discovered in the archive of the US Postal Service. Because it was kept because somebody thought it contained subversive potential.
Which indeed it did.
There was a court case in which the IWW asked for the envelope and its contents back. And it went to court, and in the court it was decided that the US Postal Service could keep the envelope, but the IWW could have the ashes. And then the IWW said, what are we going to do with these ashes? So they split up into very, very smaller amounts, and some went back to Sweden, to Galve. Joe Hill's house is still there, by the way. If you go to Galve, you can visit Joe Hill's house. And but one other bit was, one other bit of the ashes was actually given to Billy Bragg. And Billy Bragg actually swallowed a pinch of it with a glass of Union beer. And therefore, this goes full circle, because I was introduced to Joe Hill's song by Billy Bragg, and this is probably Joe Hill's most famous song. It's a song that is well known. So I'll end by singing that. If the story of Joe Hill has a moral, it's got to be this. Never introduce your girlfriend to your best friend. Otherwise you might get shot. Right, this is called There's Power in the Union, and it has a chorus, so please join in. There's power in the factory, power in the land, power in the hands of the worker. But it all amounts to nothing if together we don't stand. The lessons of the past have been learned in workers' blood. The mistakes of the bosses we must pay for. From the cities and the farmlands to the trenches full of mud, war has always been the boss's way, sir. This is the chorus, the union forever defending our rights. Down with the blackleg, all workers unite. With our brothers and our sisters from many far off lands, there is power in our union. I long for the morning that they realize brutality and unjust laws cannot defeat us. But who defend the worker who cannot organise when the bosses send their lackeys out to cheat us? The union forever defending our rights. Down with the blackleg, all workers unite. With our brothers and our sisters from many far off lands, there is power in our union. Money speaks for money, the devil take his own. Who comes for to speak for the skin and the bone? What a comfort to the widow
light to the child. There is power in our union. Last time, the union forever defending our rights. Down with the blackleg, all workers unite. With our brothers and our sisters from many far off lands.
Thank you.
The next song we're going to sing, I'm just going to do a little bit of telling you about facts. Since 1993 and May this year, 34,361 refugees are known to have lost their lives on or with or within the borders of Europe. Those are only the ones who have died. There are many, many more living in misery. In 2004 to 2015, the world was absolutely shocked by the image of Alan Kurdi's little body washed up on a beach in Turkey. Then we had floods and floods, waves and waves of refugees arriving, particularly on the island of Lesbos, which I know very well, and I know the beach that they were landing on. The kindness of the people of the island was legendary, and they helped them in every way they possibly could. Today, there are 5,500 refugees trapped on the island in a refugee camp built for 2000, and their tragedy continues because they can't leave the island because of a deal that was done between Europe and Turkey. I won't go into the details of that. So it was that wave of lives saved and lives lost, of kindness and danger and fear and loss, that prompted Bob Wally, who used to be part of Chumbawamba, to write this next song. And it's called Three Boats.
Mia Sabu Zaidi,
friends and brothers, sisters and brothers, Asumia, Situmia, Sabumia, Wakata. 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700 more. 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 more.
We have to think about hopefulness. These reminded us of the generosity and kindness, and that's what hopefully we would want to be able to embrace and encourage our governments to do the same. So the last song is a song of hope, and it's a song really written by a thought, it's a mother singing for her child. The two languages that you could hear alongside the English for the numbers were Swahili and Arabic. And this song is from a Nigerian background. So you'll hear a little bit of Hausa first, and then you'll hear the English. But it's got an affirmation, and the affirmation means, please. So, Ewe.
Ewe.
So it's our plea for and hopefulness. Ewe. Ewe. O masi fun in kulu letko
Ewe
Masi e pamle in twana
Ewe
Masi fun in kulu letko
Ewe
Masi e pamle in twana
Ewe
O child refuge,
Ewe.
Oh child, I wish for you sweet freedom,
Ewe.
Child, I wish for you sweet shelter,
Ewe.
Oh child, I wish for you sweet peace,
because every incident that's described in my story has actually happened to somebody in this country, which is a pretty sobering thought in my view. I searched around for inspiration. What on earth could I tell a story about? And in the end, I had a look on the Amnesty website and found a report called A Matter of Routine, The Use of Immigration Detention in the UK, published by Amnesty in 2017, and that's the root of my story. It was a Friday night, dark and cold, and I was driving up the M6 to a children's home. It wasn't actually the longest day in the year, but it jolly well felt like it. The headlights were flashing in my eyes as I drove up the motorway. And sitting in the car seat, strapped in beside me, was a little lad of about 7 or 8. He said he was 8, but he didn't quite look that old. He didn't say much. He just sat stoically. We stopped at McDonald's. And I thought, well, that might cheer him up a bit, but even a fluffy McDuffy didn't really do much for him. He sort of pecked at it and mumbled, and that was it. I'm a social worker, and I'd been on duty on Friday, and that's always the worst day of the week to be on duty, because always cases come in at 5:15, and there's never anyone in the office to help sort the problem out. And sure enough, I had had a phone call from a local primary school. They'd got a little lad, the boy sitting beside me, who hadn't been collected. And the head teacher wanted to get off because she'd got commitments for the weekend. And could I please come and sort it out? They'd actually sent someone round to the boy's house, the secretary had gone round, but nobody had actually heard of the family. They'd looked in his records and phoned the GP surgery. GP surgery hadn't heard of him either. They knew he was a British child because they'd got his passport details on their records. And they knew that his mum was a single parent, because nobody else ever came to collect him or showed any involvement with him. I had been round to school, talked to the little boy. What's your name? Noah. I said, yes, said the head. He's a very, very bright little lad. He's been with us since he's been in reception and got loads of friends here, haven't you, Noah? Noah just sort of nodded. What's your mum's name, Noah? It's Nora. Nora Fahasi. But she told me this might happen, I'm not saying anything, and I'm not saying nothing. And he pierced his lips together, clenched his lips together, stoically, and that was it. Sure as eggs is eggs, he said little more than that. He'd come back with me to the office, I'd made phone calls. First thing I did was phone the police. Had there been an accident? Oh, they said, we know this story. You better phone immigration. They'll tell you where she is. And I had much to do with the immigration department, and even though I'm a social worker, it didn't happen that often. And they gave me the number and I phoned and they said, what's her name? Oh, yeah, we've got her. No, I can't tell you where she's going. You'll have to find that out on Monday. Sorry. And they put the phone down. So I was faced with finding somewhere for Noah to go, at the very least, for the weekend. And I'd spent ages phoning around local children's homes, foster carers. No one had a place. Eventually I found the place I was going to, some 70 plus miles away. At vast expense, it was going to drive a hole in the local authority children's services budget. But I didn't have any choice, so that's where I had to take him. So we got up to the children's home, and he was greeted by a care assistant. A little lad looked more and more dejected as it became clear that he wasn't going back and he wasn't going to see his mum that night. And I left him there with the regulation social services wash bag and toothbrush that we give to kids in an emergency, and the clothes he'd been in all day at school, and nothing else, nothing to remind him of home or anything really. And as I left, I noticed a tear rolled down his cheek, but he still didn't say very much. Whereupon I turned round wearily and drove back down the motorway, and eventually got home and had a pretty good weekend. I did think about him over the weekend, but you know, he was one of many cases. So on Monday morning, I picked up the workload again and made more phone calls. And yes, Noah had been okay and over the weekend. He was miserable, clearly miserable. But he wasn't any trouble. And I phoned the immigration department, and yes, they'd picked her up, and she'd been sent to Yarlswood, some 200 miles away. And yes, I could visit, but I'd have to phone and make an appointment. I certainly couldn't just turn up, and no, I couldn't speak to her. She'd been issued a mobile phone, but she hasn't got a smartphone, they're not allowed them. So I made an appointment to go down and see her. I hadn't been to a detention centre before, but it really is like visiting a prison. I wasn't a lawyer, so I was treated as a social visitor. You're rubbed down, you're fingerprinted, you have to show two forms of ID, one with a photo on it. etc., etc., etc. And eventually I got in to see her. She was a slender, gaunt-looking woman, clearly quite distraught. And the first thing she asked about was her little boy. She was very, very worried about him, and I tried to reassure her, but she said there's nobody else to care for him. Then she started to tell me about conditions at the centre. This was in February this year, and she said, there are 100 women in here, all on hunger strike, because the conditions are so awful. People are being abused by staff. There aren't enough staff to care for us. And there are so many people here who've been here months and months, and they don't know when they're getting out, and they have no hope. And you should see the blood. Self-harm is every day. It's a nightmare here. Please, get me out. Well, there wasn't much that I could do. I said, well, firstly, I'll reassure you about Nella, and I'm going to visit him regularly, and I will keep in touch with you. But have you got a solicitor? Not yet, she said. Have you got a caseworker from the Home Office? Not yet, she said. So I said, well, look, I'll do my best to make sure that those things are hurried up for you. And that was the best I could offer her. And I drove the long 200 miles back and did another week's work and made more phone calls. And after a few weeks, I applied to go and see her again. And this time I thought, really, find out a bit more about her. Why on earth have they just picked her up? And they're just holding her. And we know absolutely nothing. So this time I went determined to get her story. She's Iranian. She'd had a relationship with a journalist who'd been critical of the regime over there. And he had been sentenced to 20 years. She was a Christian and knew that she too would be arrested if they hung around. And so the pair of them had arranged with people smugglers to get to the UK. I'm not going to go into the story of their journey. We know about the horrors that immigrants face. So I leave you to imagine those details. We got to the UK and they immediately applied for asylum as refugees, and it was granted. And they settled. And her husband built up his own business, selling pictures and prints. And in due course, Noah had been born. She too had been given leave to remain. And they felt reasonably happy. Now they were, despite having got into the country illegally, they were very down to earth, very honest couple. And because it was his own business, he did all the tax returns as he thought he needed to do. And the business grew and he got an accountant. And one year, the accountant made an error that he spotted. Being an honest man, he pointed it out to the Inland Revenue and told them that he would make amends. HMRC have a direct link to immigration and they reported the error. They didn't bother to report the fact that the error had been reported to them by the person who was responsible for it. And immigration then said this was a complete breach of his conditions to remain. They booked him on a flight and he was removed with no warning. When he claimed his rights under Article 8, the right to family life, he was told by the Home Office, oh, you can talk to them on Skype, can't you? And it all happened so quickly, he didn't have time to fight his case because his seat had been booked on the plane and they didn't want to waste the ticket. He'd gone. After he got back to Iran, he disappeared. And Nora hasn't heard from him since. She, however, had stayed in the country, looking after Noah and trying to keep her head down, but had been told that her right to remain was, as a consequence, under review. And she had to report weekly to the Home Office. And that had gone on for 2 years, and she had dutifully trundled to the Home Office department and told them of her presence and that all was well. Recently, just before her detention, she'd gone as usual, and they'd asked her to come into another room for a meeting, whereupon they said she was being detained and she could not go anywhere. And she was not given the opportunity to make any arrangements for her child. So that was the background that we were dealing with. I made the regulation visits to Noah, who became more and more withdrawn. The bright little lad that the school had described to me became a rather sullen, morose little boy who didn't speak much, didn't join in games, and really wasn't eating very much either. I went back to see Nora. This must be about some 8 weeks later. And she said she'd been given a caseworker from the Home Office. But when she tried to contact the caseworker was never available. She was either on her lunch or in a meeting. She simply couldn't be contacted. She got a monthly review letter from the Home Office, which seemed to completely disregard all the information she had provided and just kept on repeating that her details were being looked into with the Iranian authorities. Yes, she'd got hold of a solicitor, but she hadn't met him yet, and she gave me his name. So I, again, back to the office, really feeling I was, dealing with something that was pretty much beyond me. I couldn't change anything. Back at the office, I phoned the man who was listed as her solicitor, and he said she had got the right to remain under EU law as the sole carer of child, and he was going to contact the Home Office and would sort it out. 2 days later, he phones me and says, "I'm very sorry, love, but it's no go. The Home Office are saying, as you've got Noah, she's not the sole carer anymore. Noah's perfectly well looked after, and so yeah, we can put her on one of our flights, don't worry." And he said there was no arguing with the Home Office. That was the line that they were taking. I mulled this over and I thought, well, maybe we've just got to get Noah back to his mum, and then they can't say that. So I went to see my managers, and you probably know social workers can't move without managers agreeing what they do. And I said to them, look, we need to get this child out of here. He's going downhill, and we have to get him back to his mum, and then they'll have to release her. Their reply was, they couldn't do it because they would be accused of lacking in their duty of care. It would be seen as a bad move on their part, and surely the papers would get hold of it and their name would be mud, and they were not prepared to risk it. And in any case, under the Children Act, the best interests of the child is paramount, and nobody could possibly say that delivering a child into a detention centre was going to be in his best interests, even if his mum was there. It was too great a risk. I went home that night and I tossed and turned in my bed thinking, this is just so wrong. Next morning I woke up energised and impulsive. Went into the office, I got some headed notepaper and I wrote the letter. And I signed it in my manager's name, and I knew I was risking my job here if this got out. I didn't tell anyone, I didn't put a copy on the file, I gritted my teeth and I posted it. Copy to the solicitor, letter to the Home Office, copy to Nora. 2 days later, after the post had gone through, maybe it was a bit longer than that, Again, I get a phone call from the solicitor. You've done it. They're going to let her out. And sure enough, Laura came back to his mum. And I said, I want to keep this family on my caseload. There are all sorts of problems to sort out. You know, the landlord was in the process of emptying their flat because nobody was paying any rent, school places, etc., etc. So I asked if I could keep him on my caseload because Noah was still deemed to be a child in need of protection. Protection from who? I asked myself. And that's the end of the story. I'd like to give you a few statistics. There are some 30,000 detainees in this country at the moment. Of all the detainees that go in, 50% of all nationalities are actually discharged back to their communities. And of Iranians, 90% are returned to their communities. And the Amnesty report suggests that the numbers detained fluctuates with the number of beds available. It's a matter of routine.
Yeah.